Morning, good morning, good morning, good morning. Merry Christmas. I guess it's looking real now. So pretty tricky drive this morning. It was great. So a couple of things that we want to bring to your attention. I'm filling in for the late Eric Vandenbroek, so we're glad to see he's here now. So this coming Thursday is the Christmas Eve service, and today is the absolute deadline to sign up and register, RSVP, however the way you want to word it, so that your name is on the list and you are able to come and so on. And we want to see as many of you as possible, and we'll celebrate on the birth of our Lord. Just a little Christmas announcement. Rebecca and Matt Van Gerp are expecting their third child. I said, man, you look over this year, we've been popping out everywhere. I mean, there's all kinds. It's great. I think, did we double Christine? No, we didn't quite double. No, it's all right. All right. Communication list. Christine's working on new ones, and they should be ready to go the first of the year and so on. And then cafe hours. The cafe will be open this Monday, but then will be closed until January 4th. That's the first Monday of January. So if you were planning a trip to the cafe, please keep those things in mind. So I think I got everything covered. Let's just bow in a word of prayer, and then we'll begin our worship. Father, we thank you for this day and for this season, and we thank you that we can come together in this place. Lord, we're even more thankful for the fact that you are in this place with us, that your presence is all around us and within us. And so, Father, we pray that you would speak to us this day through the songs of worship, through the spoken word. And we thank you that your servant Scott is going to come and share your word today. And we ask that you would bless him and strengthen him and use him. Father, bless our time together. And Lord, we just ask that you would be with us in this lead up to Christmas Day and all of the celebrations, Lord, even though they're a little subdued this year. We just pray, Lord, that the spirit of Christmas and the truth of Christmas would be the true celebrating point that we look at this year. And so, Father, just bless our time together. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
And mercy mild, God and sinners reconcile. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies. With angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Thank you.
This marks the final week of anticipation, the culmination of hope, peace, joy, and now love that make up the season of Advent. In this time of year, we may very well find ourselves longing for at least one of these, and we can all agree in our heart of hearts we long to be loved. Love comes down to each of us in the Nativity story, and no part of creation is left out. Even if you do not believe in the story of Christ, it remains true and steadfast throughout history and time. May this story be as real for us today as it was for those present on that fulfilling evening. Take that one, or doesn't matter.
Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright. Stillness loomed over the coolness of the night. The sweet smell of fresh grass sat heavy in the mist of shepherds patiently guarding over their sheep. Only the murmur of their breath and breathing could be heard. Holy peace. Heavenly peace.
Down the hill, in a small village, nestled in a manger, lay a panting woman ready to burst with the birth of a child, round yon virgin. Night swaddled them in its cloak and quiet rest in their waiting. In the darkness, life was anticipating his glorious entrance. Glory streams from heaven above.
Even for us, we often lay in wait throughout the year. Wrestling in darkness, we wonder when hope will realize among those for which we pour out our body and souls. We are expended at all costs, for the cost is life. We enter the Advent season at the brink of our brokenness due to the long season of teaching, meetings, errands, travel, holidays, and care for our families. But then emerge in a fresh new season at the declaration of the arrival of love. But let us not neglect the precious gift of waiting, which is the hallmark of Advent season. Waiting brings illumination. Waiting as a gift, waiting is active as we embrace the work of the Spirit springing up in our life as we feel dormant. Remembering Emmanuel comes, the waiting ends, and the prosperous promises are full. Love has been born and dwells among us and through us.
Let us pray. Lord, as we light the fourth candle, the candle for love, let us remember the love that you have for your church, and let us take that love and extend it through our community at this time and into the new year. We pray wonderful love will spring down on Chesterville, and that we can have an impact in this community and with our families and friends. In this we pray, amen.
Good morning. It was so nice last week to see a few of you up there with Miss Jen. I wish we could all be together, but soon, I'm sure. Now, this morning, we're going to talk about a woman. And this woman is mentioned more in the Bible than any other woman. And before they even tell us her name, what they do tell us is that she is unmarried. She is engaged to someone, but she's unmarried, which means she's living at home with her parents. Now, have you guessed who I'm talking about? That's right, we're talking about Mary. Now, Mary is going about her daily routine in her house. She's in a room all by herself when suddenly the angel Gabriel appears to her, and listen what he says. Rejoice, highly favored one, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women. Now, I don't know whether he walked through the door or whether he just suddenly appeared, but whatever it was, Mary looked troubled. And so the next thing the angel said to her is, do not be afraid. And in the Bible, frequently, whenever an angel does appear to someone, one of the very first things they say to the person is, fear not, or do not be afraid. Does that mean that angels look scary, or is it just that they suddenly appear? Good morning. It was so nice last week to see a few of you up there with Miss Jen. I wish we could all be together, but soon, I'm sure. Now, this morning, we're going to talk about a woman. And this woman see if I wish we could all be together, but soon, I'm sure. Now, this morning, we're going to talk about a woman. And this woman is mentioned more in the Bible than any other woman. And before they even tell us her name, what they do tell us is that she is unmarried. She is engaged to someone, but she's unmarried, which means she's living at home with her parents. Now, have you guessed who I'm talking about? That's right, we're talking about Mary. Now Mary is going about her daily routine in her house. She's in a room all by herself when suddenly the angel Gabriel appears to her, and listen what he says. "Rejoice, highly favored one, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women." Now I don't know whether he walked through the door or whether he just suddenly appeared, but whatever it was, Mary looked troubled. And so the next thing the angel said to her is, "Do not be afraid." And in the Bible, frequently, whenever an angel does appear to someone, one of the very first things they say to the person is, "Fear not," or "Do not be afraid." Does that mean that angels look scary, or is it just that they suddenly appear? Got to remember, Mary had never seen television. She'd never seen a movie. So if he just suddenly appeared in a room, it would be pretty frightening. And then the angel goes on to say, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus." And the name Jesus means Savior. Now, Now, I've always loved this about Mary. She doesn't go running, screaming out of the room. Instead, she says to the angel Gabriel, "How can this be? I'm not a married woman." She's full of common sense. And then the angel says to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the highest will overshadow you. And therefore also that Holy One who is to be born will be called the Son of God. For with God, nothing is impossible." Now, I totally believe that God created the heavens and the earth, and the birds and the animals and you and myself. And so nothing is impossible with God. So I have no problem believing that he caused his Holy Spirit to pass over Mary and for a baby to be born in her womb. Now here's, and then Mary says, "Behold, the maidservant of the Lord, let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. What we see here is Mary's immediate submission to the will of God. She is willing to do whatever God wants her to do. Now, she's going to have to explain to her parents and to her fiancé how come she's having a baby and yet she's an unmarried girl. And a lot of people are going to criticize her for that and maybe even not talk to her because of it. But Mary is more concerned about obeying God than about pleasing man. Now, I got a question for you. Why do you think Jesus came to the earth? Oh, I think I know what you're going to say, and we'll get to that in a minute, but I've got a couple other reasons for you to consider. In the Bible, there are over 300 prophecies. Now, a prophecy is something that's told before it happens, and there's 300 prophecies that tell about the Messiah coming, about Jesus. Listen to what Isaiah says. He says, "The Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel." Now, Emmanuel means God with us. And Micah tells us that this baby will be born in Bethlehem. Now, if you look here, I don't know if you can see that very well, that's what's called a silver dollar. It's the forerunner of the loonie, okay? Now, if you took enough loonies to earn enough silver dollars, and you put an X, a red X on just one, and you filled the state of Texas up to this point. So you fill the whole floor of Texas that high I'm going to put it over here, full of silver dollars. And then you blindfolded someone and you said, okay, you walk in there and you pick out the one with the red X on it. What do you think the chances are that they'd find it in one go? Well, that's the same as if one person was able to fulfill 8 of the Old Testament prophecies, and yet Jesus fulfilled all 300 of them. That's pretty impressive. Now, my second reason is we said that Emmanuel means God with us. Now, we talk about the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. And while they each have separate responsibilities or jobs that they do, they are one. And I know that's a really hard concept for our tiny human brains to understand. So when Jesus was in the manger, God was right there with him. God was his Father, and he was right there with him. And one of the reasons that there's a beautiful song that Tammy sang last week. It's called Mary, Did You Know? And it says, Mary, did you know when you kiss your baby's face, you're kissing the face of God? Think about how special that is. I wonder if Mary really knew that she was kissing the face of God when she kissed little baby Jesus. So when you see Jesus healing the sick, making the lame to walk, what you're really seeing is God saying, I care about you when you're hurt, when you're sick, and I want to help you. When you see Jesus feed the 5,000, you're seeing God say, I care about your daily needs. And then we have Zacchaeus. He was a little man, short in stature, and he climbed a tree. Now, he was not a popular person in the community because he was a tax collector, and he had cheated people. But he wanted to see this Jesus. What was all this fuss about? So he climbed the tree, and Jesus is walking by, and he stops, and he looks up in the tree, and he says, Zacchaeus, come down. I'm going to your house today. Well, the other people thought, why would he go to a sinner's house? What's wrong with him? But Zacchaeus came down, and he said, I will give half of what I own to the poor. And if I've cheated anyone, I'll give back 4 times that amount. You see, Zacchaeus met Jesus and he was changed. And that's what happens to us when we meet Jesus too. And the final venue I want to show you is Jesus on the cross. Now he's had nails hammered into his hands and his feet. He's in the most pain that probably anybody has ever been in. And the man beside him who's also being crucified says, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Now, Jesus could have ignored him out of his own pain. He could have said to him, you're a sinner. You deserve what you're getting. I didn't. But instead, Jesus says to him, today you will be with me in paradise. And then he looks down and he sees his mom, and I'm sure she's weeping. And he sees his good friend John standing there. And he says, woman, behold your son. Son, your mother. And the Bible tells us that from that day on, John took Mary into his own home and cared for her like she was his own mother. See, Jesus was still concerned about his mother, just like he's concerned about any widow who's left alone and needs help. That third reason, the one that you're thinking of, Jesus came to die on the cross to take the punishment for the wrong things we think, say, and do, the sins that we commit. The sins that you commit, the sins that I commit. He took the punishment that we deserve so that we could have a right relationship with God. Now, I'm sure, I know many of you have asked Jesus into your hearts, but maybe some of you haven't done that yet. So I encourage you this Christmas, when you look at the Nativity, when you realize that that baby in the manger is God and that he loves you so much that his own son Jesus was willing to take your punishment, I pray that you'll ask him into your hearts. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you and praise you because you are God. We thank you that you love us so much that you created this beautiful world for each one of us. We thank you that you sent your son to show us how much you love us. And we thank you that you died on the cross in our place. Lord, I pray for each one of these children that you'll bless them this Christmas, that they'll have a wonderful time with their family, and that they'll just really understand the true meaning of Christmas this year. And we will give you the praise and the glory for all these things. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
child is this who laid to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping, whom angels greet with anthems sweet, while shepherds watch are creeping. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds. Gold and myrrh, companions and kings to me.
Work?
Yep.
Oh boy, that's loud. I'll speak softly, maybe. Okay, we can put the first slide up, please. Okay, so this holiday season, I think you would be inclined to probably sit down and read. It doesn't look very good outside. It looks like you're going to be spending your time indoors. And I know this time of year, I tend to get my Bible out, and I tend to get out the commentaries that I have, and I just dig deep. And I asked my students, and if you don't know this, I'm the youth director here. I asked my students about a month ago whether or not I should speak on a particular topic, and it was crickets, and then crickets again. And one student, though, brought up about 10 days ago that I should speak on the early church fathers. And it makes sense because they're relevant today, even though we don't see them as much. When you open up your Bible at the beginning of the books, there's very often a passage giving the historical context of what happened and why, based on the writing of one of the early church fathers. Or if you read a daily devotional like the Daily Bread, you'll find that very often there's a reference to one of these early church fathers as confirming what was seen by Paul or one of the other writers. So I want to give you a little bit of an introduction to them as a whole, and then some guidance for how to read them properly within the context of Scripture. And so we're going to be looking at 1 Peter 3:15 as our guide as to how we should read these passages from these authors, because they're not all the same. 1 Peter reads, "But in your hearts revere Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect." And this verse is one that very often dictates my entire youth teaching. In fact, it came up on our Bible Unearthed segment just last week as we're finishing our series there. I always tell the kids that I need them to take away something from what I'm teaching. There has to be something meaningful, and you do it, you have that preparation then to take it to others. So, next slide, please. So why is this topic relevant today? Now, Advent is a season that often follows Christmas messages and the birth of Christ, and I didn't feel very outfitted to do that type of message today. Maybe next year. But it is a reminder, and Advent season is all about reminders. And it's fitting that this week, the fourth week of Advent, is the week reminding us of Christ's love. And I want you to consider the stories you know about the early church fathers and what I talk about today in light of that, because they had such a love for Christ that they worked out so many of the issues that were fought later on, and they were willing to die in martyrdom for Christ. It goes back to 1 Peter 3:15. So the new year brings with it often resolutions. You're going to start hearing in the next week, people are talking about my weight loss resolution, my healthy eating resolution, better physical activity. Those are at the top of most people's lists. but there's a growing number of people that are turning their hearts and minds to growing spirituality. And it makes sense, right? With this weather that we're having, with all these lockdowns and people being stuck indoors, people are seeking something more than what they already have. And for Christians, I find that it's often a refining moment for us. We can sharpen our faith a little bit during this time. This is why self-help books become bestsellers, and there is a genuine interest in Christ from those who might not otherwise consider him. They don't know they're looking for him yet specifically, but they're digging and they're digging. And I remember one of my volunteers told me years ago, they corrected me, and it was a really good comment to make. I said, let me check out some Christian self-help books to see if we can get some help for you. And they said, what are you talking about? That's not self-help. That's Christ helping you. And I thought, yeah, there really is no such thing as Christian self-help. It just doesn't exist. That's something completely different. It's not Christ. And so for me, especially in Canada, like I said, this is the time of year that I get into deep reading, contemplation, and prayer. And I reflect a lot on Ecclesiastes 3:1-8, which says that there's a season for everything. And my youth will remember the first year that I took over, we worked on Ecclesiastes. And that's a book that always sits well with me, because even in times like this where I am struggling to find something to do to get out and get fresh air, I need to remind myself that I now have a wonderful opportunity to sit in study and in scripture reading. And we can go to the next. Yes, thank you. So, just a basic introduction. Patristics is the study of the early church fathers. They are often described as leaders or bishops of the early church in the 2nd through 5th centuries, and that's a little loose. Some faiths will take that further or earlier. And they're recognized for their role in shaping the early church. They were instrumental in their positions and as host of councils and creeds that formed our canon and some of the earliest universal beliefs. And I want to be clear, and I'm going to try to make this clear throughout, that they themselves are not uniform. They did not recognize themselves as one group or as one team in the sense that Catholics, Lutherans, Protestants, Episcopalians, Orthodox do today. They would not, it's like trying to take history and put it into this world where they would be on different teams, like you would say, they're part of my team. No, they're part of my team. When we read them in light of 1 Peter 3:15, and we analyze their writings with Scripture and their actions with Scripture, we can get a better sense of where they fit. Next slide, please. Yep. So just a few points about why they might be worth reading today and used for biblical study. They are venerated by the Catholics, the Orthodox, and the Eastern churches. And there's a misunderstanding that their writing is not compatible with Protestant or evangelical faith. You won't see it too much in sermons today, and you won't see it in too many books today, but their writing was instrumental in helping the Protestant Reformation come to light and come to fruition. I think their writing is relevant today because many of them were dealing with the same things we're dealing with. Remember that sin and evil existed just as then as it does now. And you will find many parallels when you read them. For example, Augustine wrote extensively on the temptations of the flesh and with his personal battle with pornography and adultery. These aren't anything new, and especially for our generation, there's a lot of that around us. They were vocal on the idea of heresy and had, in my opinion, the guts amongst their fellow believers to stand up for what was right amongst the crowds who would be the only ones to support them. You have to remember at this time that nearly all of them were martyred. They had no reason to do what they were doing, to fight amongst each other, to battle it out, to get Scripture correct, because they had every reason to die for believing what they believed in. And if they would have just kept quiet and kept to themselves, they could have avoided all of that. So I think that's a powerful indicator of their faith. And of course, they were the first to articulate the Trinity as we know it today in writing as God the Father, God the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And let me see here.
Yes, okay, perfect. So just a few points that I think are pretty powerful for considering reading them. I wanted to bring up Cold Case Christianity. That's another study that the youth did last year. And that's one where J. Warner Wallace, a professional police detective and once staunch atheist, explains how he was challenged by another coworker to use his detective skills to build a case as to whether Christ really existed and if the works that he had accomplished really were accomplished. And so one of the big things that we talked about in that study was the proximity to Christ's life and how that matters or doesn't necessarily make things better than today's theologians. So we have this idea sometimes that if you're the earliest or you're the first, you're necessarily correct. And he was really great to point out that in a crime scene, somebody that's the first witness is not necessarily the one that has the most accurate story. Just as today, there are some people from that time period, namely the Gnostics, who wrote about Christ in a perverted way and were not in line with Scripture. Today, you can find that as well. But on the other side of that, you can also find great theologians today who are thousands of years removed from the life of Christ, but through Scripture and prayer are able to write some powerful testimony that we can learn from and that we can take. And again, it goes right back to 1 Peter 3:15. So we talked about witnesses and we talked about crime scenes in that book. And he referred to the gospel authors as likely living and writing within 100 years of Jesus' events and resurrection. What's cool about these guys is that many of them were students of those authors and those apostles of Jesus. And of course, I mentioned it before, they had everything to lose, right? We talked about this with J. Warner Wallace. Why would you go about teaching Jesus' word when it was either illegal or likely to cause death in pagan Rome and Greek culture? Reason number two, students of the New Testament and authors and their disciples. So they had this connection that was really cool, and I just noted a few of them here. There's quite a few now, and I'm not saying again that these people are necessarily, certainly their teaching is not in line with level to Scripture, but we can use some of it to understand Scripture better or to understand the time better, which will give us an indication of what the early church was like. So Ignatius was a student of the Apostle John and was likely the first author to reference Paul's epistles in writing as authoritative and as God-inspired. So he was famous for sending out pieces of paper to all these different church communities, verifying that Paul's writing was scriptural. Polycarp was a disciple of John and the author of the Gospel of John, and is remarked by contemporary authors to have been the only one living with those who were witnesses of Christ. So he actually had firsthand experience. What was another one here? They were writing from authority from New Testament connections. So I want to be clear too. Sola Scriptura is maintained here. I'm not saying that these are equal, but these can be powerful people, inspirational people. For somebody like me who is a history lover, it's really rewarding to go back to that time and read a lot of what the people were dealing with in relation with Christianity and the emerging church. Next slide, please. Reason three, before the Council of Rome and contributed to the canon. So the Council of Rome was actually a Catholic council that verified the books of the Bible that we know today and later what was reformed. But Irenaeus in the second century was the first to propose in writing the four Gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John to be accepted as the only four Gospels in the New Testament. And if you know anything about early church history, that many of these communities were already circulating these books amongst each other. There was an acceptance that was near universal that is really cool to go back to. When we studied J. Warner Wallace's study, we found that many of the early churches didn't need necessarily a Bible like we see today where everything is in order. Through God's grace, they were able to put these together and circulate them amongst themselves and come to an understanding that these are indeed God's word. Augustine was responsible for petitioning the inclusion of the book of Hebrews, though, which did not circulate well and could have been lost. That's quite the blessing. Athanasius began publishing letters among the church proposing the exact same New Testament books that we have today, all 27 that made canon. That's quite the accomplishment as well. If these early church fathers' writing existed before divisions in the church, and they were the ones that prayerfully and scholarly decided what would become our holy book, their individual writings can be useful. And again, a reminder, go back to 1 Peter 3:15. Please note that I'm not challenging the sola scriptura, but reminding you that these early church fathers were responsible for being at the front table of what happened in the early church, and it's worth looking into. Reason four, learning to do theology, as they say, by seeing those before us who did it. So what do we do with what we learn from our reading? It's important to take whatever we would read today, whether it's a modern theologian or one of the early church fathers, and line that up with scripture. How do the two compare? Reformers quoted the early church fathers extensively and give greater context to their positions and where we are today as a church. This is something that's really interesting if you read the works of Zwingli or Lutheran or it'll come to me in a minute. Their writing specifically moves the church away from the Catholic tradition with the help of the early church fathers. They use their writings to inform how we can find our salvation in Christ alone and in Scripture to lead us there. Next slide, please. And then the big warning, Matthew 24:24. For false Christs and false prophets will arise and will show great signs and wonders so as to mislead, if possible, even the elect. As you go through these books and as you have time to wind down in your reading this winter, and even as you read your Bible, keep this in mind. Keep in mind that there will be things that you read that sound really good, that sound convincing, but you'll always have to bring that back to the Bible, and I always bring it back to something like 1 Peter 3:15 to make sure that what I'm reading is in line with biblical teaching. A great theologian or teacher that is biblically based is timeless. I wanted to also make it clear that martyrdom and great faith does not necessarily equal biblical teaching. And John MacArthur talks about this quite a bit when asked about the early church fathers. He says, I know I'll see these guys in heaven, but I wouldn't necessarily pigeonhole them into a particular topic, or I wouldn't try to teach somebody who wasn't already interested in early church. If you have an interest in ancient history, if you have an interest in the kinds of things that the apostles' students were dealing with in the 2nd through the 5th centuries, it gives you quite an idea of the struggle of the church. Remember to read these authors in the context of their ever-growing and changing lives. I think it's really interesting that we can read these with all of our knowledge today in the 21st century, that so much has been hashed out, not just the Reformation, but the Catholic Church, even in its early days, and some of the ideas that are coming out today from, you know, really powerful and really influential authors. They didn't know all of that at the time, and they didn't have that all hashed out. And so this is a really great introduction to some of the basic tenets of the faith and some of the things that worried the early church that we can still see today, actually, through our own sin and temptation. Next slide, please. And that's nearly the end, and I just wanted to give you a couple of references. The good news is, like the Bible, the early church fathers are accessible for free. You can find their writings online. Most universities that have ancient history departments have all of them published online, and you can see them as well as with commentaries. I have one with John MacArthur with his commentary with that as well. I would offer three in particular that are fairly interesting. Augustine, he was influential in my early life, and his earlier writing is actually more align with a Catholic faith. And I think you would be surprised and excited to hear that as he grew older and as he became an adolescent and wrote more, that much of his writing lines far more with a Protestant faith. And it shows that growth as he read scripture. Origen is really interesting because historically, all of his writing is nearly a copy of the New Testament. He references every single piece of the New Testament except for 17 verses. That's pretty remarkable. So one of the earliest commentaries on the New Testament. And then finally, Justin Martyr. This was a really fascinating one for me that I just learned about recently, that his writing was all about seeking Jesus in the Old Testament. He was looking for, as we talked about this morning, in the children's story, how Jesus is found in all of prophecy in the Old Testament. He worked hard to make sure that the early church understood that everything goes together. So I think that's quite remarkable. Next week, I want to talk to you on something quite different. We're going to be looking at a parable in Mark chapter 12, 41 and 44, and the same story from Luke's perspective in chapter 21, 1 through 4. And again, a bit of a history lesson, something you're familiar with, but with a tiny little twist that I think will get you excited. So let's pray, please. I pray that as we read the early church fathers, Lord, or any other instruction or theology, and of course our most precious gift, your holy word through the Bible, that we remember to keep in line verses like 1 Peter 3:15, as we grow in our love for you and celebrate that love with others in this holiday season. Let us take all weeks of Advent with stride, spend time with family and friends where appropriate, and set aside time for you in the new year so that we can grow and become all that you thought we would be and all that you know we will be. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Noel, the end. I would just like to close us in prayer.
Heavenly Father, I just thank you that we could come together and praise and worship you, and I thank you that it is Advent season, and as we lit the candle of love, and we just wait in anticipation for whenever you do, we celebrate the fact that you did send your Son to save us from our sins, that we can also show Christ's love to our family and friends and those in our community, and to really drive that point home that this is the time as Christians that we can celebrate that not anything that we did, but only what you did, God, saved us from our sins. And we just thank you for Scott's message as well, that there's so much information available to us to dig deeper in. For those who do have some unbelief, God, there's so many ways to prove that you actually did what you said, and you fulfilled all those prophecies with sending Jesus. We're so thankful for that. I just pray for safety for each person as they travel home, in a bit snowy conditions. And I also thank you for each person that's here and that could also watch us online. And I just pray that, your Holy Spirit will work in each one of our hearts. In your name we pray. Amen.